What's up, people? It's your girl, Adeola. Last week, Nigeria lost a hero, a man that a lot of people have described as Nigerian Army's most efficient fighter, a Lieutenant Colonel Mohammad Abu Ali. Him and six other soldiers were ambushed by Boko Haram on November 4th. The others that died with him are Muazu Ibrahim, Husani Jafaru, Basi Okon, Chukwu Simon, Salisu Lawal, and Patrick Paul. May their souls rest in peace. Now, you know what is so upsetting about this story? This man did not have to die. That's the upsetting thing. Premium Times spoke with a soldier after Abu's death. They were like, why is it that since September of this year, Boko Haram has killed a lot of soldiers than usual? They cited several examples. Major DS Erasmus and eight other soldiers that were killed on September 25th in Bama, Lieutenant Colonel Yusuf and 83 soldiers were declared missing since October 16th when Boko Haram attacked them in Gashiga. Lieutenant Colonel M. Abu Ali and six soldiers were killed on November 4th, and the following day, two soldiers were killed at Kwada during Boko Haram attack, and then the day after that, another soldier was killed in Kangawa while four others were wounded. And you know what the soldier said? He said, well, they still do not have the latest weapons, the latest equipment in the fight against Boko Haram. I was like, what? And he said the weapons that they bought for them in February of 2015 when we were preparing for elections have worn out compared to what Boko Haram is using. Please get me, Mr. President. Mr. President, you're welcome. By the way, you've offended me. But before we get to your offense, did you not read this article? A soldier revealed in this article that your administration is yet to procure new weapons for the soldiers. I don't know who is lying. Is it the soldiers? Is it the Nigerian government? Because if that's true, then Nigeria is still knowingly wasting the lives of our soldiers. Can we please do something about it, Mr. President? Not only that, I heard that on the day that this man was killed, that one officer and 49 soldiers were suddenly removed from that location in the morning, leaving Abu Ali and a few soldiers. And then they were attacked at night and they were killed. Nigerians are asking for an investigation. Could it be that there's a deliberate calculation to kill this man and the other soldiers that died with him? And now to your offense, Mr. President. I cannot believe that you did not show up for this man's funeral. I don't understand that. I thought that if other presidents don't understand, as a former military general, that you would understand. No. Nigerians are disappointed, Mr. President. How can you be in Edo cutting ribbons when they were burying a man that is believed to be the bravest and the most gallant soldier in the Nigerian army? Haba, it does not speak well of you. This man was granted special promotion from a major to a lieutenant colonel within a short period of time because of his courageous performance in a series of the army's engagement with Boko Haram. And the president did not show up for his funeral? I'm not saying that the president should cancel his trip to Edo, but after arriving Edo at 11 in the morning, he could have come back for this man's funeral at 5 p.m. I'm sure that Oshiomhole would understand. And if you must go back to Edo that same day, you have several private jets, Mr. President. It's not more than a 30-minute flight. So the truth of the matter is, many people have been asking, is Nigeria worth dying for? So many people have given their lives for Nigeria, but we quickly forget about them. Some of them today, their wives, their children are barely surviving. What did we do to honor Wing Commander Chimda Hedima? Remember the pilot that was beheaded by Boko Haram? What did we do to honor him? And what would we do for Abu Ali, for Muazu Ibrahim, for Husani Jafaru, for Basi Okon, Chukwu Simon, Salisu Lawa, Patrick Paul, Lieutenant Colonel Yusuf, Major DS Erasmus? And these are just the few that we know about. Abu is not the only courageous one. Every single one of our soldiers that did not back down, even in the face of death, they are all courageous. Nigeria, how would you remember them? And how are you taking care of their family, their children especially? Please let me know in the comments below if you would be willing to die for Nigeria. You guys know I don't know much. Guess what? I'm just keeping it real. Moving on to Ghana, elections are coming up on December 7th and the race is presently tight between incumbent President John Mahama of the National Democratic Congress Party and renowned lawyer Nana Akufo Addo of the New Patriotic Party. There are so many similarities between the Nigerian election that we had last year and Ghana's election that is coming up. For example, Mahama became president in 2010 when the former president of Ghana, Atta Mills, died in office. Just like Goodluck Jonathan became president when Yar'Adua died, Mahama completed the 2 years of Atta Mills before he was elected in 2012 for his first term, and then Goodluck Jonathan completed Yar'Adua's term and served one term before our elections last year. Also, Mahama is 57 years old, Goodluck Jonathan is 58, and the opposition candidate Nana Akufo Addo is 72 years old while Buhari is 73. Addo has run twice, this will be his third time, just like Muhammad Buhari ran three times before he became president. I'm not saying that Addo will become president or not, I'm just pointing out the similarities. So if either of these two main candidates get to watch this video, video. There are so many things that I will say today that you will not like, but these are things that people are saying because I spoke with several Ghanaians about this story. So if you want to gain the trust of the people, you should address these issues whether or not you win this election. So let's start with the present President John Mahama. In the 6 years of President Mahama, Ghana has seen a lot of infrastructural development. This man has built new roads. He has widened so many old roads, and he has also built schools, so many schools, and he's given free school uniforms. And I heard that he has plans of building new universities in eastern Ghana. Mahama has also built nice hospitals. I've showed you guys some of the pictures of the hospitals that he built on this show. And he has equipped some hospitals with better equipment like CT scan, even in northern Ghana. Now that's a huge deal because a lot of Ghanaians complain that the north has been marginalized. They say that southerners are the key players in the Ghanaian politics, that they don't feel like they're part of it, and most politicians only focus on developing the south. Keep in mind, Accra is towards the southern part of Ghana. Also, Kumasi is towards the south. So the good thing is, Mahama is actually from the north, making him the second president that Ghana has ever had from northern Ghana. So a lot of people like that. Mahama also prosecuted a member of his own government, that is Abuba Pele. Although the man was never sentenced, but he was prosecuted. And also 34 corrupt judges were exposed during Mahama's time. I know I talked about that on my show in the past. In terms of policy, Mahama has been saying a lot that everything that he's done in Ghana is just the beginning, that if people vote for him, he will continue with the infrastructural development, he will build more schools. So he's saying that people should vote for him so that he can continue with the good works that he has started. Now let's talk about the not so good side of Mahama's administration. The main problem that Ghanaians have with President Mahama is corruption in his administration. And according to Ghanaians, that in itself could be a perception. They're saying that Mahama himself may not be corrupt, but there are definitely a lot of corrupt officials in his administration. So yes, he built roads and hospitals, but the argument is that the money allegedly spent on this project don't rhyme with the value of the project. For example, the former transportation minister claimed that she spent $1 million, as in $1 million US, to paint portraits of past and present presidents on 116 buses. And people were like, that is like spending $8,600 on repainting a bus. Haba. Of course, that minister stepped down. Also in 2014, the Savannah Accelerated Development Authority claimed that they spent 13 million CDs, that is more than $3.2 million, on planting 5 million trees. People are saying that's outrageous. Now, the ridiculous thing is that they couldn't account for the 5 million trees, they could only account for 700,000 trees. And the same ministry said that they spent 15 million CDs, that is about $3.7 million, on buying guinea fowls for farmers. But reporters only found a handful of guinea fowls. The worst part of the story is that the chief executive officer said that the birds flew to neighboring country Burkina Faso in search of food. Corruption. After people started shouting, after some months, he said that the guinea fowls are back. And speaking of Burkina Faso, a contractor said that he spent $650,000 to build a fence around Ghana's embassy in Burkina Faso. This is the fence that was built, $650,000. So people were outraged. They were like, this money can build a new school, this money. I mean, $650,000 to build a fence? Are you kidding me? Keep in mind that this is the same contractor that allegedly gave Mr. President the gift of a brand new 2010 Ford Expedition. So he gave it as a gift to the president in 2012. That's the same year that he won that contract. So Ghanaians were asking, did Mr. President collect bribe? As a matter of fact, BBC asked him the same question.
What about you, Mr. President? Have you been offered a bribe before?
You mean as president?
As John Mahama.
As a human being?
As a person.
Any human being in the world would have encountered, you know, corruption in a way, one way or the other.
Anyway, he later said in the interview that he'd never taken a bribe.
Either being offered a bribe or a bribe being demanded from you. What you need to do is to put yourself in a position.
Mr. President, did you take it?
No, I haven't taken a bribe.
Also, Mahama awarded the contract of drilling out the Odo River to his brother. Now, this is a river that overflows each year and it's one of the reasons for the flood that kills people in Ghana. In the dry season, it dries. So people have built houses around it. They throw dirt in it and they defecate in it. So during the rainy season, the government would have to drill the dirt and everything that people put in it. So some Ghanaians are not happy that when Mahama came, he gave that contract to his brother, who's a contractor. Others argue that, well, what else do you want him to do? Should he have awarded the contract to Chinese men, it's better that he should give it to a Ghanaian. His brother is a Ghanaian. So there's a huge controversy about that.
And speaking of corruption, a lot of Ghanaians are upset that popular Ghanaian businessman Alfred Agbesi Wayome is still working freely despite allegedly duping the nation of 51 million cedis. That's more than $12.8 million.
Alfred Wayome has been acquitted and discharged on the two counts causing financial loss to the state and defrauding by false pretense.
Although it happened before Mahama's tenure, but a lot of Ghanaians were hoping that Mahama would take up the case. However, the man is still working freely today. He's been declared not guilty. But keep in mind that this man is a financier of Mahama's party.
Today, all those who have insulted me, done all that because of false information on it, I have forgiven them.
And speaking of the economy, many people are not happy right now that under Mahama, Ghana went back to borrowing money from IMF, World Bank, China, and so on and so forth. So these are the issues that people are bringing up when it comes to Mahama. He's building and he's constructing roads, but people are saying that he needs to address corruption. So now let's talk about the main opposition candidate, Nana Akufo Addo. He was the Attorney General from 2001 to 2003 and the Minister for Foreign Affairs from 2003 to 2007. For 5 years, Addo worked at a law firm in France, so he not only has experience in international corporate transactions, but he's also fluent in French. He has a law firm in Ghana. In fact, some of the lawyers from his law firm are reportedly among the most outstanding lawyers today in Ghana. So his biggest strength is human rights advocacy and promoting democracy. He was the first chairperson of the Ghana Committee on Human and People's Rights, and as Attorney General, he supervised the repeal of the criminal libel law, which had been used to intimidate the media and criminalize free speech. Nana is one of the people who advocated that the ruling party should not be the only one that would have access to the state media. And also in 1995, he was one of those who led the demonstrations of the Alliance for Change, which mobilized millions of Ghanaians to protest the harsh economic conditions of the Rawlings era. So he was also very instrumental during the Acheampong military era in the restoration of multi-party democratic rule in 1979. In fact, he had to go briefly into exile after the referendum because his life was in danger. As a foreign minister, he was fully involved in the successful ECOWAS peace effort in Sierra Leone, Liberia, Ivory Coast, and Guinea-Bissau, and he was also the chairman of the ECOWAS Mediation and Security Council in 2003. In terms of policies, Nana Akufo Addo's main agenda, according to him, is to fight corruption. Akufo Addo said that if he's elected, then he would fight corruption, he would clean up Ghana. That's what he's been promising people, and he's also promising that he would make education free till students get to the university level. Now, the main problem that people have with Nana Akufo Addo is this. A lot of Ghanaians are saying that he's arrogant and he's tribalistic and that he has issues getting along with people, even people in his own party. Don't quote me, these are just Ghanaians talking, okay? Keep in mind, Nana is Akan, that is the largest ethnic group in Ghana. But even that claim that he's tribalistic is up for debate because people like Rawlings, they are saying that he's not tribalistic. Another issue that people have with Nana is that his party, that is the NPP, a lot of people are saying that it's not that different from Mahama's party, that is NDC, when it comes to the issue of corruption. And that's because during the era of President J.A. Kufo, that is the last NPP president, the NPP had several corruption allegations against them as well, just like people are bringing up under Mahama. For example, the son of the former president acquired a hotel. He used his influence while his father was still president
to get a Ghanaian bank to finance the $3.5 million loan.
He bought the hotel and a lot of Ghanaians had issues with that. And then there was a leaked tape in which the party chairman, that is Haruna Esaku, allegedly said that the president had directed bribes from awarded contract to be sent directly to the presidency instead of sending it to the party's headquarters.
They call it kickback.
So people were like, you guys are collecting bribe and it's going directly to the presidency. So that has some kind of stigma with Nana's party. So whoever wins this election, I think that it would be good for them to address these concerns that people have been expressing, especially about corruption. And another thing is that it would be really wonderful if Ghanaians outside Ghana can be allowed to vote remotely. I think that would be greatly appreciated. Once again, I'm not Ghanaian and I don't know much about Ghanaian politics. I spoke with people that are for Addo, I spoke with people that are for Mahama, and people that don't care, people that said they are not going to vote for either of them. So hopefully the two candidates will take these things into consideration. Whether you win or not, it's good to address these things. Now you guys know I don't know much. Guess what? I'm just keeping it real. And for our rapid news of the week, it is now a crime in Tanzania to impregnate a schoolgirl or marry an underage girl. Yes, so now guess what? If you do so, you are facing 30 years in prison. Say what? 30 years in prison? Father! I think that they are using this drastic measure because Tanzania has one of the highest adolescent pregnancy and birth rates in the whole world. Now, two things are fundamentally wrong with this equation. First of all, even though 30 years may scare some men away, no one is addressing the fact that many of these girls are given out in marriage by their families, by their parents, simply because of poverty. Second of all, once the girl gets pregnant, she's not allowed to continue her education. So many of these girls have been kicked out of school. So even if this law scares men away, what's the point if the girl is kicked out of school once she gets pregnant? So I want to know what you guys think. Is 30 years too much of a punishment? Because that means that the father of the baby would be in prison for 30 years. How would she take care of the baby all by herself? So let me know what you think about that. And moving on to Kenya. For several weeks, hundreds of Kenyans became refugees in their own country. Now, these are people that moved to Uganda when the violence broke out during the elections in 2007. And they've been refugees at the Kayadogo camp in Uganda for the last 9 years. So the Ugandan government said it was time for them to leave, that Kenya is stable. And then the Kenyan government also invited them to come back, promising to give them money to start small businesses. And they also assured them that they would convert their children's Ugandan education certificate into Kenyan certificate so their children can continue their education. But when they came back, they said that the government refused to keep its promise. So as a protest, about 460 of them camped outside the parliament since October 4th. However, their number was gradually being reduced. The rumor is that government officials were giving them bribe for them to leave because the government is seeing them as menace in the capital, Nairobi. So, but a few days ago, government officials sent buses promising these refugees that they were going to take them to the police station for verification. When the buses came, a lot of them actually fled. There were about 75 of them there and they fled. Only 35 of them were packed in the buses with a lot of children whose parents had fled when the government officials came. So they forced them to get in these buses, except that they didn't take them to the police station. Instead, they took them outside Nairobi to a place called Nakuru and they actually dropped them off at the petrol station in the middle of the night. This was like 2:30 in the morning. So it's very sad how these people have been treated by the government. A lot of them are camping at the Red Cross. I mean, they just dropped them in the middle of nowhere. It's so not fair and they are still asking for the government of Kenya to fulfill its promise. And in the Democratic Republic of Congo, ladies and gentlemen, this is November. Congo is supposed to have an election this month, but until now, the Electoral Commission is yet to announce a date. What is going on? As you guys know, Kabila's second term officially ends on December 19th. It's very clear that Mr. President is trying to remain in power by fire, by force. I mean, why would there not be an election if the president means to leave after his second term? Meanwhile, opposition members are saying that if he continues as president on the 20th of December, that there will be trouble. They said that they will consider it as a constitutional coup, which means that on December 20th, my people, there may be some serious riots in Congo. Keep in mind that about 50 people were killed in September while they were protesting against Kabila's obvious intent to stay in power. As a matter of fact, the opposition party displayed the bodies of 6 of those people that were killed just to make a statement that Kabila is killing them. And speaking of elections, the US has elected a new president. Ladies and gentlemen, Donald Trump is now the president of America. So Trump beat Hillary Clinton by winning the electoral vote. Funny enough, as we were having this election here in the US, some people were having a mock election in Kenya. Like, seriously, people were actually voting. Like, I mean, so now people have been reacting all over the world since Trump became president. This is a Nigerian family that went out to eat in Nigeria because Trump became president in America. They said that it's a triumph of good over evil, righteousness over unrighteousness. And while they were counting the votes, I thought I should share this picture. It was shared by a Nigerian. The man posted a picture of a man feasting. So there has been mixed reactions since Trump became president. And of course, Nigerian president sent out a tweet to congratulate Trump on behalf of the people of Nigeria. Now, the funny thing is how Nigerians reacted to Mr. President's tweet. Some people were like, Mr. President, really, who sent you? Others said, Buhari on behalf of which people? Next time, can you just say, I, Buhari, congratulate Trump? Nigerians. And speaking of tweets, this is a governorship aspirant in Ondo State, Barrister Jimo Ibrahim. He said, congratulations, Donald Trump. Looking forward to working hand in hand with the US government to make Ondo State better. I'm sorry. You have to love my people. I'm very happy for him. You think Donald Trump knows In case my brother is watching, I'm very happy for you, for your tweets. You got our attention. I'm sorry, but I'm not sure that Donald Trump knows about Ondo State. But not only that, the president of South Africa, Jacob Zuma, also sent his congratulations. And he said on behalf of the people of South Africa, only for South Africans to also descend on him. They were attacking him. They said on behalf of who? Eh? Why can't you speak for yourself? Americans get their own Zuma. Who's now? This is my African people. Why now? Why are Africans making fun of this? Someone posted this picture and said these are the flights back to Africa if Donald Trump wins. And also the president of Uganda, Yoweri Museveni, that has been in power for 30 years, sent a congratulatory tweet to Donald Trump as well. I congratulate real Donald Trump upon his election as US president. I look forward to working with him like I've done with his predecessors. And of course, Ugandans were reacting left and right, but the one that caught my attention the most was from Jeffrey Smith. What's up, Jeff? He said, I can pretty much guarantee you that Trump has no idea who you are or where your country is. But Jeff, why now? You completely destroyed the man. How about Jeff? Someone sent me this video by Timmy Dakolo. Take a look.
Pack my bags, I'm leaving town. I bought a one-way ticket, I ain't coming back. It's goodbye, friends, and goodbye, folks.
Okay, Nigerians will not kill me. Can I just say, in case anyone is out there that is afraid, to all those who are scared right now because Trump became president, Trump is not going to deport 11 million illegal immigrants. I mean, I may be wrong, but I don't think he would. They contribute immensely into the economy of the US. They pay taxes, and they are doing a lot of dirty jobs that a lot of Americans would rather not do. I'm just saying that people should stop freaking out. Many of them have children here in this country. Who's going to take care of their children? I don't think America would want that burden of taking care of their children as well. And do you think that the US is not aware of all these illegal immigrants all these years? Not that Obama has not been deporting people, but Trump had been saying that he would deport like all the 11 million illegal immigrants. And speaking of Donald Trump winning the election, didn't Prophet T.B. Joshua prophesy that Hillary Clinton would win this election?
10 days ago, I saw the new president of America. Enormously, 99% vote for this woman. And the woman narrow win.
Your dad, thank you very much. My people, what happened? My dear, what happened? People all over the world are now asking Prophet TB Joshua what happened, because his prophecy went far and near. If you think that you know what happened to this prophecy, please let me know. We are all wondering what happened. You guys know I don't know much. Guess what? I'm just keeping it real.
Growing up in Kenya, my sister and I were very close. But like any sisters, we fought a lot. She always got new clothes, and I always got hand-me-downs. Now, she's putting her children through school in Kenya. We still fight sometimes, especially when I send money for the kids. I tell her, buy some clothes for the younger one, and we both laugh.
With nearly 500,000 locations, our app and online, this is Moving Money for Better.
Alright y'all, it's been real and I'm keeping it real right up in here. Don't forget to follow me on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. Until next week, I'ma see y'all later. Peace out!